Prairie Town Meeting is made possible through a grant from the Farmers Home Administration.
At the heart of our town, should North Dakota encourage school consolidation? Good evening, I'm Charlie Johnson. Welcome to another edition of Prairie Town Meeting. Tonight we'll look at an institution at the heart of many towns, the local school. Often it seems a town's identity is built around that school, its teams and its students. But North Dakota's population is shifting. Some say we have too many schools now with too few students. They see a need to consolidate. But let us first warn you that consolidation has become something of a dirty word in North Dakota. State officials are instead pushing a first step. They call it restructuring. Restructuring, they say, does not necessarily have to mean consolidating one school into another. The goal is more often sharing administrators and teachers, or even something as simple as sharing books. But each school district that enters into the state's school district boundary restructuring program has to eventually put a plan for reorganization to a vote of the people in that district or annex to another district.
I think the outcry from the public is we need to do something different. We can't keep doing things the way we've been doing it for years and years and years because it's no longer working. We're no longer competitive in a world market. The global economy requires different things of our kids, and we aren't preparing them for that global economy.
Kids need parents. They need both their parents, and you start boarding them out or having to put them on buses or have them travel great distances, you're asking for problems. And if you keep them closer to home, you can share communication, you can get involved in their school.
Tonight we'll take a look at school consolidation from the perspective of both large and small North Dakota communities. Joining us live from Towner High School is John Vigestad. John?
Thank you, Charlie. In Towner, I should say, this is one of five school districts in this area, along with Towner, to form the North Central Consortium. This district is formed and could be one of the new mega district school districts in the state of North Dakota. Back to you, Charlie.
Thanks, John. It's not just small schools that are looking into possible mergers. Here in Fargo, we'll talk about West Fargo's first steps toward cooperating with Fargo. Also tonight, we'll go live to Bismarck, where Dave Thompson's standing by. Dave, good evening.
Yes, thank you, Charlie. Of course, with the legislature in session, school district consolidation and restructuring is on the table, and there's a lot of discussion about it at least the last couple of days. Here we'll talk about the legislation that's on the table. We'll also hear from districts in the West and what they think about the school restructuring program. Charlie?
Okay, Dave, we'll talk to you in a few minutes. Remember, you are what Prairie Town Meeting's all about. We'll have panelists to act as resource people, but the questions and comments that make our discussion will come from you, whether you're in one of our studio audiences or at home. We'll get to as many of your questions as time permits. Last summer, in a poll of rural North Dakotans, 59% said they favored providing incentives for consolidation of school districts. 80% said they think incentives should be provided for schools to share administrative services, teachers, and other personnel. We want to know what you think. Now here's Bob Dambach to explain how you can take part. Bob?
Well, we'll get the camera over here in a second, but we want you to know that we do care about what you think about this question. And our question tonight is, should North Dakota encourage school consolidation? We're looking for a yes or no answer, and we have a toll-free number, 1-800-359-7788, and we want you to call in and let us know what you think about that question. Also, we would like to know at the same time your answers, because we will forward the results of this poll to the legislature, who is dealing with this question right now. On top of that, if that's not enough, we have a resource guide that deals with the question as well. And we would like to get your name and address and send you your very own viewer's guide, all this at the toll-free number. If that's not enough, well, in addition to that, also tonight we will be asking you if you have a question for any of our panelists to let us know when you call in, and we'll try during the show to get as many of those questions as possible answered. So give us a call. It's toll-free, 1-800-359-7788. We're waiting to hear from you on tonight's question. Now back to Charlie.
Okay, Bob, you've got that pledge your support thing programmed in. That's good. That's good. Right now, 56 North Dakota school districts are getting paid by the state to reconsider their boundary lines, to see if forming a consortium with their neighbors could improve educational quality and cut administrative costs. Six districts in McHenry and Ward counties are now in the second year of a three-year exploratory program. Producer Dave Wahlberg takes a look at the North Central Consortium.
Each of these students is worth another $165 to their school board because of the school district boundary restructuring program. That money, in addition to a $20,000 planning grant, is a major shot in the arm in these days of post-referral budget cuts. Financial incentives are the state's way of promoting school consolidations. The philosophy is that there are just too many small districts in North Dakota to deliver quality education in tight financial times.
The outcry from the public is we need to do something different. We can't keep doing things the way we've been doing it for years and years and years because it's no longer working. We're no longer competitive in a world market. The global economy requires different things of our kids, and we aren't preparing them for that global economy. The world situation is so much smaller. We need to prepare our kids for a whole lot of different things than we did 10 years ago. And so because of that, change is necessary to make it work.
Consolidations are not new in North Dakota. In 1918, there were 4,700 school districts. By 1961, that was down to 1,010. And today, there are just 280 districts. Still, many say 280 is unworkable. Reducing that number is an issue that gets to the heart of many towns. Teachers and administrators worry about their jobs. Communities worry about losing their school and town identity.
It is, I think, unfortunately true in North Dakota, especially in small towns, that the town's credibility is based a lot on the success of their football team, and I think that's wrong.
All right, let's go to Karlsruhe, or let's go to Velva first so I can go to Scan so I can see everybody for a minute. Okay, Velva, who wants to be first?
This interactive television class is an example of how the Granville, Karlsruhe, Sawyer, Towner, and Velva schools cooperated even before the North Central Consortium was formed. And it may well end up that cooperative efforts are the only end product of the consortium process. The voters of these districts must approve any consolidation plan. If they say yes in 1992, the reorganized district begins July 1st, 1993. If voters say no, the financial incentives stop.
They feel that once we start sharing something, it's the end of their school or the end of their community. And I think if they would have looked at this 5 years ago and started sharing, we wouldn't be in the mess we're in now.
Ultimately, the decision makers will be the voters.
Absolutely, yes. And I hope that they're informed.
Dave Wahlberg for Prairie Town Meeting.
We'll be taking questions and comments from our audiences and viewers in just a few minutes. For our studio audiences, if you'd like to speak, just raise your hand and we'll get to you as quickly as we can. First, let me introduce our panel tonight. In Towner, Roy Laframboise, president of the North Central Board. Roy, thanks for being with us tonight.
It's nice to be here.
In Bismarck, we have Tom Decker, who happens to be director of the School Boundary Restructuring Program. Tom, we'll get back to you in a minute.
Good evening.
And in Fargo, Roger Holney, who is the superintendent at Hatton. Roger, nice to have you with us tonight. Let's go to Bismarck first, Tom Decker. First of all, Tom, can you give us an update of what's been happening in the legislature on the school restructuring bill? In fact, I believe there have been some developments today. Is that correct?
That's true, Charlie. The Senate Appropriations Committee today approved $4.4 million of funding for the restructuring program. That compares to $8.2 million that the governor requested in his executive budget. That would put the funding for consortiums at $165 the first year, $125 the second year, and $85 the third and fourth years with no fifth year payments. Now, up to this point, the payment level had been $125 to $165 for that entire five-year period.
The last we heard here in Fargo was that there were some amendments being debated this afternoon. Did anything change on the Senate floor?
As of the last we heard, Charlie, those amendments were not on the floor, and I think there's a good chance that they'll be on the floor in the morning, and the effort there will be to increase the funding by some $800,000.
Well, how do you feel about this, the proposal for $4.4 million? Is that a program that you think is workable and will help?
Well, I suppose compared to the $3.9 million we had a couple of days ago, it's workable, but we believe that the last legislative session made a commitment to the consortiums who have gone ahead and taken the risks and done the planning and got into the program, and the funding level that's being proposed is significantly less than they anticipated and expected when they got into the program.
Okay, we'll be back to you in a minute, Tom. Let's go to Towner. Roy Laframboy is the president of the North Central Consortium Board. The North Central Consortium is seen as something of a leader in the state's restructuring program. What's working and what perhaps isn't working in your program?
Well, I think the biggest thing is our program is going very, very well, and I think the things we're doing to enhance education are probably the keys to that. We've added guidance counselors in our schools. We've added Spanish program. We've got a gifted and talented program. We've got an art program. We're doing some things through interactive TV. And we've done a lot of sharing things other than that. So I think those programs are going very well. We've improved the quality of education in the schools participating in our consortium. So that's been very successful.
People, when people first hear about the restructuring program or consolidation, they think, oh, they're going to close my school. I don't like that. What's been the reaction in the North Central Consortium to that? Have you had to close any schools?
No, and a consortium is a partnership, and so it's a sharing. And that's what we're looking at, is improving the quality of education. We're not looking to close any schools. If a school decides they should close, that's up to that individual school district to take that upon themselves. I think a consortium functions in just about the opposite role, by helping to improve the quality of education and by starting the sharing concept, sharing of resources with the surrounding school districts. It actually makes it easier for a school district to stay in operation and offer a good quality education.
Okay, well, let's hear what another superintendent has to say about that. Roger Holney here in our Fargo studio from Hatton. You take a little bit of a different view on consolidation. In fact, I guess you've decided to drop out of the Heart of the Valley Consortium. Why was that?
We took a close look at it. We studied it for almost a year, trying to decide what would be the best interest of our district. And some of the things we looked at, one was that we were doing a lot of sharing already. Some of the things that we were sharing where we shared a guidance counselor with Northwood and Central Valley, Spanish instructor with Northwood, football and baseball with Findlay Sharon, elementary principal with Mayport, industrial arts with Mayport, regional teacher in services that we have together. We have computer network. We have satellite technology that we've used. We've used a lot of these sharing things already, and I agree that sharing and working together is very important. But in our case, we're also concerned about local control.
Are you afraid, did you feel that in your consortium, we're going to go to our audiences shortly, so have your questions ready, but did you feel that in this consortium you were losing local control?
I think we definitely were. One of the things that our consortium talked about was that we would not guarantee that there would be any schools open after the time of the annexation. In other words, the interim board, the new school district, would have the power to close any high school or elementary school if they saw fit. And the idea was they thought they needed this flexibility for the future, rather than saying we're just going to keep schools open to keep them open, that those needs may change. Also, our mill levy was about 35 mills lower than the other three school districts. And that makes it a little tough to sell to taxpayers.
Tom Decker in Bismarck, you've been listening to this. Do you have any comments about what Mr. Holney has said?
Well, Charlie, one of the appropriate outcomes of a planning process under the program is that a district may decide that the program is not for them and withdraw from the program. Superintendent Holney talked about a variety of cooperative activities that his district is engaged in. Those cooperative activities are really stretching the resources of a lot of superintendents across the state as they try to enhance their programs by cooperating with as Superintendent Holney said, about five different districts. One of the advantages of a consortium is that hopefully the cooperation on all of those things would be within the consortium, within one administrative structure, and be a lot less time consuming, a lot more efficient.
You've heard people talk about local control over their schools, Tom, but does a point come when the state should step in and say this school district is too small, it's not efficient, that there has to be some form of consolidation? What's your view on that?
Well, the state constitution clearly gives the authority to provide elementary and secondary education to the North Dakota State Legislature. Now, the legislature has delegated control and management of schools to local school boards, and we believe that the restructuring program is well within that traditional partnership between the state and the local government in terms of providing for education. The restructuring program provides incentive money and a process through which local districts, groups of districts, can look at their educational needs. But local school districts do have complete control over the decisions about the institutions that will stay open in their area and about the kinds of educational cooperative programs that they pursue within the consortium.
North Dakota has, stand by, Bob, I know you've got a question. North Dakota has, I believe, 280 school districts. Is that right, Tom?
That's correct.
Is that too many? Apparently it is in this case, at least in your view. How many are enough in a state like North Dakota? Have you done any calculations?
Well, over the period of the last 80 years or so in North Dakota, the number of school districts has changed dramatically as a lot of things change, transportation systems and a variety of other things. Right now, we are undergoing a major shift in population from the rural areas to the urban areas. And there are a fairly large number of schools who are in a situation where their enrollment has declined in some cases by 50% or more over the last 10 years and are down to the point where they quite frankly are at risk of not being able to provide programs by themselves. The solutions to the problems that they face due to declining enrollment and tight budgets are not to be found in continuing to work alone. They will need to work with their neighbors in some fashion. And the boundary restructuring program is designed to provide those kind of alternatives.
Okay, Tom, we have some questions ready now. Stand by in town, or John, we'll be with you in just a second. First, let's go to Bob Dambach. Bob has a question that's been phoned in. Bob?
Sure. A new wrinkle during this Prairie Town meeting is we are taking questions on the phone. Toll-free number 1-800-359-7788. If you have a question you'd like to ask a panelist, please call that number and vote yes or no on our issue today. A number of questions have come in from Western North Dakota, and basically I think what the people are saying, consensus here, is that they're wondering if this consolidation will really improve education. They feel that the money that has been put into education since the 60s has not really upgraded reading levels or skills, and they're wondering if consolidation will indeed be something that will help the students or is just another thing.
Okay, let's go to Roy Laframboise and get his comments on that. Roy, you're a supporter of the consortium program. How do you feel about how it's affected educational levels?
Well, I think there can be a real positive effect from the consortiums. The thing is, we need to share. Enrollments are declining, and unless we can get together and share resources, there's really no way that we can address the problems we're facing. When enrollment declines, financial support from the state declines, and unless you've got some way to overcome that or to combine resources, there's no way you can deal with those problems.
Roger Halney, what's your take on the educational effects of combining resources?
Well, I think combining resources is good. In a lot of cases, we are combining resources across the state, I think, more than most people realize. The key is local control. And another thing, to consolidate, there's got to be some educational reason for it. I think there's got to be some proof that the schools aren't doing the job. And that may be true in some cases. In some cases, consolidation may be necessary. In the case of Hatton, our enrollment has increased by 33% since 82-83 school year. And so I don't think you can say that one answer fits all school districts. I think it's a matter of individual choice.
Okay.
In each district.
Okay, we have another, we have some people waiting with a question in Towner. John Vigested, are you there?
I am here, Charlie. I'm not sure exactly this is going to be in the form of a question because I couldn't find any of the adults in the audience who wanted to ask any questions right now, so find three high school students from Velva High School, and they are involved firsthand in a consortium. They all are taking interactive classes through television. Why don't you give us your name and what grade you're in?
Jennifer Linder, Jr.
Michelle McIndy, I'm a senior at Towner.
Carolyn Hillerwood, Jr.
Do you, through the interactive television, do you get to know the students in the other schools as you would not be able to know them elsewhere?
Yeah, to some extent.
How do you enjoy? Do you find that, now what classes are you taking, interactive?
I'm taking Spanish.
College bound English.
Spanish.
Do you feel, would you be able to get these classes had there not been some kind of an arrangement made between school districts? In other words, would this class have been offered?
No, it wouldn't have. We would have just had our senior English.
What do you think about it? Is it more difficult to learn with interactive television or not?
Yeah, I find it difficult because, well, you don't have the teacher in the room with you and you can't, you know, like have hands-on experience. You know, if you have a question, you got to raise your hand and wait until she gets the camera on you and then you ask it and then, I don't know, it's different.
But it is better than not having it all together.
Yeah, it is.
Thank you very much, ladies. Back to you, Charlie.
Okay, John, thank you very much. Bob, I believe you have, I hear the phones ringing. You must have another question back there.
I think we have a Tom Decker fan club here. Here's one question for Tom. At the level of current funding or the funding that's proposed right now, will school districts be shut out of consolidation?
Tom?
The funding level that's proposed under either scenario that's before the, or now before, or we suspect will be before the Senate, is going to delay at least adding consortiums to the program. The proposal now provides planning grants for 6 additional units, but they would come on stream in 1993. There was a feature in the package we brought to the legislature that would have provided money for pairing arrangements between large districts like Bismarck, for example, and outlying smaller districts. That is, those small districts could have purchased educational services from a Bismarck. That money has been eliminated entirely, so that part of the program won't be available.
You say you had, now there are 4 consortiums operating now, and the bill that's being discussed today would provide planning grants for 6 more. Do you have a waiting list? How many school districts are actually interested in setting up consortiums?
We have 4 consortiums that are receiving per pupil payments this year, about 3,500 students. We have 8 additional consortiums whose cooperative plans were just approved by the State Public School Board yesterday, and want to implement programs in September of this year, pending appropriate funding from the legislature. Those 8 consortiums include about 12,000 students. We have 6 additional consortiums on the waiting list who would like to implement program in the fall of 1992, and within the last week we have started a waiting list for 1993.
Okay, we have another question with Bob Dambach. Bob?
Okay, we have a couple people calling in, one from New Rockford, and they're wondering if in this consolidation, if there's any limit on the distance that students can be bused.
I guess we'd have to go to Tom for that one again, too. Distance besides funding, distance is a crucial element when you talk about sharing schools and restructuring, right, Tom?
That's true, Charlie, and the control over which buildings will operate, what grade level configuration will operate in those buildings, and consequently the distances that students will be bused remains totally a matter of local control.
You're not providing any, you don't have any guidelines that you're issuing though, like 50 miles is too much or anything like that?
Not at all. Those guidelines are at the discretion of the local district. We are encouraging them to look at efficiencies in their transportation systems and to do studies that allow them to maximize the efficiencies in their system and keep the ride times down.
Roger Halney here in Fargo, the Hatton superintendent. Well, when you dropped out of the Heart of the Lakes Consortium, do you feel that you risked this may be more a political question than anything else, but did you risk giving up some of the cooperative gains you may have made in the process?
I hope not, but there was a little feeling of being left out in a couple of the districts, I think, that we were cooperating with. I hope we can continue to cooperate with them and share services and maybe add some of those to them also. But we didn't really want to limit ourselves just to 2 or 3 other school districts. We wanted to keep sharing with a number of school districts in the area.
I take it that the Hatton School District, in your estimation, is as you've said, extremely viable right now, financially and otherwise, then?
Well, it is right now, but it's hard to look, 10 years into the future. So it's a tough decision knowing whether to go with a consortium or not.
Okay. Roy LaFrambois, has travel been a problem in your consortium at all? Have you had to make any changes in the cooperation that you've established as far as the busing of students goes?
Okay, we're not busing students. We're moving teachers from school to school. So the transportation thing hasn't been a problem for us. We do have some cooperative athletic programs, and of course there's busing of students involved there. But as far as the educational programs, that's a moving of teachers.
Have the teachers complained at all about going from school to school?
No, it's been a very positive thing. It's interesting for the teachers to do something new in different settings, so it's worked out very well.
What kind of distances are you talking about when you say you move a teacher from one place to the next?
Oh, not more than, say, 15 or 20 miles in one move, and then they may do that twice during the day.
All right. Roger, was the travel a consideration for you?
In our district?
Mm-hmm.
In our district, it was planned that we'd operate four separate high schools. And so the idea was that there would be no travel. But our concern was after the consolidation took place and we had one school board, that then we would lose local control, and that new school board then could decide to move students without the approval of, say, the Hatton or the Hillsborough or the Findlay-Sharon or Mayport district. And that's what we were afraid of.
Okay. We have another question, I believe, in Towner. John?
Thank you, Charlie. We have Jane Ruprecht, who was on the video piece early in this particular program. She teaches at Velva High School, and one of the things that's concern of some teachers, I'm sure, is what does the consortium hold for them? Does it mean a loss of jobs, a loss of whatever?
Yes, it is it's a real concern. Most of the teachers who live in the small towns and work in the small towns are homeowners. They have children in the schools. They have lived in the communities for most of their lives. And right now, having to face the possibility that they will not have a job in 2 or 3 years is very frightening. One of the things that alarms me a lot is that the money that had been requested for teacher retraining has been cut from the budget also. And so there is a good deal of anxiety.
Do you feel that will continue as the months and years go by?
I think it will, unless we can come up with some kinds of procedures or guarantees that people will not be displaced arbitrarily, or they will not lose their professional status arbitrarily.
Maybe that's a question that we could ask some of our panelists to see if there is any such guarantee that could be provided.
Very good question.
There you go, Charlie. Work on that one.
Okay. Would anyone like to respond to that? Tom Decker in Bismarck?
Charlie, we have been strongly encouraging the four consortiums who are operating this year to develop consortium-wide reduction in force policies so that when and if enrollment configurations in those districts change, or when schools are consolidated, enrollments are consolidated, that there would be an orderly, predictable, and mutually acceptable to the management and to the teachers procedure to reduce the numbers of staff members that did need to be reduced.
Okay, thank you, Tom Decker, and our other guests. We'll be back with Tom in a minute. We've been asking you what you think of school consolidation. Bob Dambach is here now with an early update on the voting. Bob?
Okay, we've had about 80 phone calls so far, Charlie, and it's running 50-50. Yes and no. Your answer to the question, should North Dakota encourage school consolidation? Don't forget, we will be providing the legislature with the results of this poll. It is a toll-free number that you see on the screen. We'll send you a request, we'll send you a viewer's guide that you just saw on the screen, and we'll also try to ask panelists your questions. So don't put it off. Give us a call right now, 1-800-359-7788. We want to know what you think.
Okay. Thanks, Bob. We'll be back with you shortly, too. If you drew a line dividing North Dakota eastern and western halves, you'd see a lot of schools in the eastern half participating in the state's restructuring program. Almost no schools in the western half. Producer Becky Jones looks at why western schools are choosing to remain independent.
Western independence. Individual school pride.
Nowhere will you see a better example of independence and pride in Western North Dakota communities than on their basketball courts. Mott and Regent are playing tonight, old rivals, who may soon have to talk about sharing more school services. But not now, not tonight.
I can tell it's a very intense rivalry between the parents, and parents make it the big rivalry, I think, more than the kids do.
As you travel through the western part of North Dakota, I think you will see a great deal of pride within each individual school, and I think it answers some of the questions as to why the Western half probably hasn't jumped into the consortium idea as some others have.
I'm sure Beach has a very strong independent nature. We're proud. We're proud of what we have, and we're proud of our education system. But I don't think that we're so proud that we would close our eyes if we felt that we were hurting our students. We have an excellent school. We can provide services that we feel that are more than adequate for our kids. Consolidation really is not a, it isn't feasible for us right now because we have so many miles between the schools.
Living out here, you know, in the prairie, we're 45 miles away from Belfield. I wouldn't want to spend 90 minutes of my day commuting, you know.
I think what we would accomplish with restructuring and lending our services to other schools or gaining services from other schools that we could benefit from to enhance our educational system could be done easily as well through interactive TV.
Schools like Beach and Mott are hoping to share teachers with their neighbors via satellite rather than making kids or teachers travel. Right now, Mott does share a speech teacher and guidance counselor with Regent.
We feel that we're sharing those things that are advantageous to both schools, and we can do that and still maintain our own identity.
You know, as far as combining, I think change is scary, and they're not ready to do that. You know, and they always, consolidation to some people means closure of something, which isn't necessarily true, but that's what's on everybody's mind.
But not everyone in these towns is against restructuring.
I think it's a needed thing. I think it's something that we, you know, have to face squarely due to our dwindling population. And I sometimes think more of us in towns of this size should be thinking about it, should be doing something about it.
Even the current Mott School Board is also not ruling out the idea.
We may, 2 years from now, see a great advantage in it.
This is Becky Jones for Prairie Town Meeting.
Let's talk a little bit about consortiums and consolidations and cooperation in Western North Dakota. Our guests for this section of the program in Bismarck, Roberta Hildebrandt, the Beach School Board President, whom you've already seen on tape. Bobby, nice to have you with us tonight.
Thank you.
And again in Bismarck, Tom Decker, Director of the School District Restructuring Program, whom you've heard from before and will again. And Dale Gilgey, the Beulah Superintendent of Schools in Towner. Dale, nice to have you with us tonight.
Thank you.
Bobby, let's start with you. You're just a few miles from the Montana border, and there aren't really a lot of schools around you, I don't suppose. Is consolidation or restructuring completely out of the question for your school?
It definitely is out of the question for our school. It's not feasible, our geographic location, for one thing. We certainly couldn't restructure with Montana with state guidelines being so different. We firmly believe that the method of restructuring for our district is to go with interactive television. That would provide an incentive program, an enhancement program for all the students, and it would be a type of program that could reach every student in the entire state of North Dakota. In fact, we've been advised that for $10 million or less, that every student in North Dakota could be put through interactive television, could enhance their education program, and we definitely feel that that's the best solution for a method of restructuring.
Are you using any interactive TV now?
No, we presently don't have interactive television, but we do have the CIRSE program.
Explain CIRSE for me.
Well, CIRSE is a satellite program that we have purchased through Prairie Public, and we bring in various programs such as Japanese, Russian, macro, microeconomics on a college level. And it's provided to our students, and it's through a television base, and we have guidelines set up that our students who excel in classes can participate in this program. And it provides our school with curriculum that we don't otherwise offer.
Tom Decker in Bismarck, what about the transportation problems in the western half of the state? Is it possible that Bobby is right, restructuring doesn't work for every school district?
That's certainly true, that restructuring is not for every school district. I would point to another school district in the western part of North Dakota, however, as an example of the size that does exist out there. The McKenzie County School District covers 1,400 square miles. That's fully as big as most of the consortiums that I'm working with. So the conception about appropriate size of school district, and they only have one high school, varies quite a bit. And local people need to come to their own conclusions about what appropriate distances are for transportation. Now, the other point that I would make is that consortiums should be viewed as administrative units, and
and the consortiums that I'm working with, it's virtually certain that many of them will have multiple high school attendance sites and multiple grade school attendance sites for a long period of time. There's a good example of that right where I'm sitting. I'm sitting at Century High School in Bismarck, North Dakota. I taught at Bismarck High School for 14 years. Those two districts have an intense rivalry in a variety of sports, but they're part of one administrative unit.
Okay, let's go to Towner quickly. Dale Gilgey, you're the superintendent in Beulah. Your school in Western North Dakota is part of a newly formed consortium, but I understand it was a little bit of an uphill battle getting it together. Can you tell us why you think that was?
Well, I guess we've taken a look at it for about the past 3 years. The need to cooperate is definitely out there. We do not have the money resources or the people resources to do it on our own. I happen to attend a very small school. I understand the pride that's associated with it, but I also understand the frustrations of not being able to have a class available to you because there is not a staff member or something. We've worked 3 years in our area to put together a consortium, and I don't know that it is one that's going to be a lasting one because we cannot address the real hard issues. We do agree that we need to cooperate and share services. But when it gets to the local control issues, it's a whole different ball game. We had 15 meetings, the first of those very fruitful, but when we started putting down the actual attendance sites with potential problems, it's caused a lot more concerns.
Did you find, very quickly, then we want to go to the audience, did you find that, that distance of travel is one of the major stumbling blocks in your consortium?
Yes, that is a problem. It's not just the sheer distance, it's the inaccessibility of traveling east and west. Basically, our school districts are all north-south school districts along highways or railroads, and we don't have a road every half mile or mile.
Okay. We have some questions standing by. I believe the first one is in Towner. John?
Your name and where you're from?
Colin Johnson from Bantry.
Okay. And a parent, what question do you have?
Have any of the existing consortiums seen any financial benefits through the attrition of administrative staff?
Okay, Charlie.
Okay, let's hear what Dale has to say about that.
Well, I guess we're just in the planning stages of it, and for us, we have not had any, we're not approved yet. We were just approved, yesterday. So we don't have any sharing that has taken place that wasn't already in place.
Tom Decker, perhaps you can address this question. Do you know of financial problems that have developed in the existing consortiums?
Charlie, there will certainly be sharing of administrators in consortiums as the plan develops. We need to remember that we're halfway through the first year of a three-year cooperative program. We've done some calculations, figuring on administrative services needed in Nelson County, for example. We believe that ultimately they may go from 9.3 full-time administrative positions to probably 7.3. That's not a large reduction, but the other part of that is that those administrators, those 7.3 positions, will have significantly different job functions than they do today. Many of them will be working more directly with students and teachers than is currently the case.
I believe we have a question waiting in Bismarck. Dave Thompson?
Thank you very much, Charlie.
Your name?
I'm Horace Sileston. I'm on the school board at Fordville, North Dakota, in the northeast corner of the state. And we are presently in the fourth year of a co-op arrangement with a neighboring town of Lankin. Our numbers got so small we couldn't keep on by ourselves, so with joining with Lankin, we created a very viable school district. We did it for two reasons, better education and to save money. And I guess my question is, will the consortiums save money?
Tom?
Charlie, we have told all of the consortiums that we're working with that they should not get into this program to save money. The research at the national level is pretty conclusive in regard to the fact that reorganization and consolidation don't save significant amounts of money. What we believe they will do is provide significantly greater educational opportunities and significantly better use of resources in providing education for children.
And of course, if they save money in the process, that's okay, I suppose.
Certainly.
Okay. I believe we have a question from our video audience. Bob?
Okay, Charlie. Once again, we do want to remind people you can call that toll-free number, register your yes or no vote, and ask questions. I've had a number of people call in, and I guess the thrust of this is that they wonder, first of all, if any planning grants had been established to kind of do sample consortium programs, and secondly, if consortiums are such a good idea, why has the legislature in the past few days voted back some of the money that was allocated for consortiums?
Okay, thanks, Bob. Tom, well, of course, there is a planning grant involved in this program, right? It's a planning grant that goes with being involved in the consortium?
That's correct. When a group of school districts that meets the program's criteria apply for a planning grant, they receive an $18,000 or $20,000 planning grant. That money is to do just that, to plan, to see if they want to stay in the program and pursue it through the 3 years of cooperative activity.
I've kind of been waiting for someone to ask this question about the legislature now. Why does there appear to be a reluctance to fund the program? Obviously, you can't speak for the legislators, Tom, but you're out there monitoring it every day, I'm sure. What are the objections that the legislators put forth?
There are a variety of reasons. Different political parties are talking about the end numbers. The Democratic Party, I believe, it holds the view that they should end up spending about $20 million less than the governor has proposed to spend. The Republican Party, news reports have it, would wish to spend significantly less than that, say 30 to 50 million less than the governor's budget. And that money has to come from somewhere. In the political process, when consortiums are moving from 1.2 million to a budget request of 8.2 million, that's viewed by some legislators as a very large increase in spending and therefore subject to some cuts.
Okay, I think we have a question waiting in Towner. Is that true, John?
We sure do, Charlie. We have a face that was on a videotape report earlier. In fact, he's welcoming us to his Towner and letting us use his school to destroy for a couple of hours, at least filled it with electronic gear. And you had a comment.
Yes, I really don't have any questions at this point, but I do have some comments about our consortium, which is the North Central. And maybe I'll have a question when the legislators come up dealing with the wisdom and cutting back on funding for the second year. But I'll save that for later. But I guess the comment I have is what we looked at here in North Central was that we did a projection of student enrollments and we did a projection of what we considered would be our student needs. And the future is where we've been looking to, not to the past. We haven't been content to say, well, it was good enough 10 years ago, so it's good enough today. We want to say, well, what do we need for tomorrow? So when we did our enrollment projections and what our kids really are going to be needing down the road, it's kind of scary. And I think it would be kind of scary in every school district in the state, other than the big metropolitan areas. They probably have the luxury of growing. But as a general rule, we were losing about 25% of our population in the next 6 to 7 years, student population. Well, that translates to dollars, and that translates to more taxes, and I think that translates to December 5th votes and those types of things. So what we do is we cut back on programming to make it by, and we've done a good job of that in the past, and I think it's to the point now where we don't have any more flexibility to cut back. We've got to look forward, we've got to be futuristic, and we've got to say that this consortium is going to go.
Okay, thank you, Larry.
Okay, John, thank you. Bobby Hildebrandt, you heard Larry Gagelman talking about how they look to the future. When you say that you don't think a consortium is feasible in Beach, how far into the future are you looking? Do you feel that the school can maintain its viability for a long time to come?
I feel that Beach could definitely maintain its education system that we presently have. We have an outstanding education process with a very wide curriculum offering. We're definitely looking at advanced technology, and in working with Ted Renner, we're trying to work into the Southwest Interactive Television Consortium. I feel that the Beach, along with many other schools, provide an education to students that is far above what you can offer by restructuring. We have varied programs. We are constantly on the alert for new technology ideas. We offer every kind of curriculum subject that we possibly can, and if we don't have it, we research until we can find a means of making it available, like through interactive television satellite system.
Is the population, though, declining in your school district, and is that a concern for you if it is?
We've had some decline in numbers. Right now, we're not extremely concerned, but there definitely is a decline in numbers. Our hospital has closed and they're trying to reopen it. That takes away some of the families if we can't reopen it. But presently we've been maintaining.
Okay. Okay, let's go to Bob. Bob has a question he's been holding here for a minute. Bob.
Okay, I've got 20 questions. They're all the same one, from Grand Forks, from Towner, from Zapp, from Mott. The opinion is that there's too many administrators, too few teachers, and teachers don't get paid enough. About 20 people held that opinion. What's our response from the panel?
Oh, who wants to tackle that first? Tom, let's go to Tom quickly. Anyway, Tom, how do you feel about the fact that some people think there are too many administrators, too many teachers, and that the teachers, that there are too few teachers, and that they don't get paid enough? Is that one of the goals of a consolidation or consortiums, to sort of move the pie up a little bit?
Certainly, we're aware that teachers in North Dakota are not paid very well. The last numbers that I heard were that we're 48th in the nation in average teacher salaries. I dealt with the issue of administrative positions before. I think the consortium process is going to reduce the number of administrators somewhat, but what it will do certainly is significantly change the roles that administrators play in those districts. In Nelson County in 88, 89, we had seven high schools operating with just about 300 students between them. Seven operating districts, seven superintendents. In a Nelson County consortium, there would be one superintendent and a number of other administrative positions working at the building level directly with teachers or working as assistant superintendents with curriculum and other things that have more direct impact on what our students get and consequently on the outcomes that we see from our students.
We have a question here in Fargo. Before I do that, though, I'd like to get Dale Gilgey back into this. You're getting involved in a consortium, Dale, as a superintendent. Are you afraid that ultimately your job might be in danger here because of this?
I guess I don't see that necessarily, and I think there's a perception out there that we're overstaffed, and I really don't believe that at all. I've been involved in education for 29 years. If you're providing a service, you're needed, and the numbers problems that we face have to do more with population than they do with too many administrators. They translate kind of one to the other, but not directly.
Okay, thank you. We have a question here in Fargo.
Yeah, I had a question for Roberta, and you'd been referring to the interactive TV, that was a good solution, but yet we heard from the high school students that said it's not quite the same as having the teachers there. So I'm wondering, what are your reasons for thinking this is the best solution?
Bobby?
Well, personally, we feel that in a situation like Beach and many other smaller schools who have such a distance, interactive television will provide the subjects we don't have. True, it's not like having your teacher in the classroom, but it's as close as it can be with having the monitors and the student-teacher interaction. And we really feel that it is a workable situation because there's such a varied offering. And students are our number one priority in North Dakota. They're the future of North Dakota, and we have to provide every opportunity we can. So we look to interactive TV as being one of those means.
All right, we have another question in Towner. John?
Thank you, Charlie. Can I get your name and where you're from?
Yes, Louise Korfmacher. I'm a teacher here at Towner High School. And I wrote my question down.
Okay.
I was wondering how the panelists feel. Is it inevitable that the individual schools that have joined a consortium will eventually lose their identity? And would this fact have an effect upon the way the community feels about the consortium?
Okay, Charlie.
Dale, did you run into that concern as you were setting up your consortium in Beulah?
Yes, it's very much a concern that the consortium will affect the fabric of the community. But I think one thing we have to keep remembering, change is going to happen if we plan for it or not, and I think we're better off by planning for the changes that may come about.
Okay, we have a question, I believe, in Bismarck. Dave?
Yes, Charlie. I was handed this one. If it is the sharing that is so beneficial, why can't the state financially encourage the schools to share without the end result having to be consolidation? If the threat of the schools losing their local control was gone, more schools would be apt to share also. I'd like to get the feelings of the panelists on that.
How about you, Tom Decker in Bismarck? How about just put, I believe Bobby Hildebrandt has said, and she can correct me if I'm wrong, has suggested that instead of putting this money into planning grants and so forth for consortiums, it just be put into foundation aid for all the school districts. Is that a better incentive?
Certainly one of the possibilities that the legislature has to consider is that this could be put into foundation aid. However, when we look at what's happening to the demographics of rural North Dakota,
they're going to have to ask themselves, you know, whether that's the best choice or the only choice. There are 73 high schools operating now that have 50 students or less. Over the last 10 years, those high schools have lost 40% of their enrollment on the average. Bigger schools from 50 to 100 have lost 30% of their enrollment over the last 10 years, and the high schools in the 100 to 200 range have lost 20%. The projections that we've done in 12 consortiums show decline in enrollment in each of those 12 consortiums ranging from 3 to 27% over the next 7 to 8 years. So we believe that some change, some process to allow school districts to consider change is absolutely essential given those kind of demographic situations.
Okay, thank you, Tom. And to our other panelists now, we're going to move on. I know we have a question or two waiting in some of our audiences. Hang on to those because I'm sure they will be germane as we move through to our next section. But right now, let's go back to Bob with an update on the voting. Bob?
Okay, our question tonight, once again, should North Dakota encourage school consolidation? So far, 149 calls and 74 yes, 75 no. It is very, very close, as you can see. Make your opinion felt. We will forward these to the legislators in Bismarck. They'll know about the poll. Also, you can get your own resource guide. We'll get your name and address, and you can ask a question of the panelists as well. So give us a call at that toll-free number you see on the screen right now. We're waiting to hear from you. Back to Charlie.
I know that 50-50 split is going to help those legislators make up their minds. Just what they wanted to see. The school district boundary restructuring program was created for small school districts. Under the way it's currently written, it excludes the state's most populated schools from receiving money. That doesn't mean those in the larger school districts are excluded from consolidation talks. In fact, two of the state's largest districts have met twice already to explore possible cooperation. They don't want to use the word merger yet. Dave Wahlberg tells us about what one of those superintendents is calling their courtship.
West Fargo is a city and a school district on the grow. New homes mean new families paying new taxes and growing student populations. But in a very real sense, West Fargo is a district damned by success. All of these new students have meant that West Fargo has borrowed millions to build new classrooms. $6 million for this high school alone, and 4 years later, it's already too small. It seems residential property does not pay its way.
The homes don't provide the tax base that that one would think they would. If we have a new home that goes up in West Fargo, and if we have two or three children that live in that home and they come to school, the cost of educating those children certainly is more than the taxes that are paid on the home.
At West Fargo's request, the Fargo and West Fargo school boards have been meeting to talk cooperation, even merger. It's what Fargo Superintendent Vern Bennett calls a courtship that in time may lead to marriage. Both superintendents agree at the heart of this situation is inadequate state funding.
One problem is that we're behind almost a decade in just basic funding to begin with, and we certainly need a lot of assistance in getting our basic foundation funding up to a level that would represent at least keeping up with past inflationary growth, which we haven't done.
As West Fargo makes payments on its debt of millions and wonders how it will maintain educational quality, it also looks to the $8 million in the governor's budget for school reorganization, money it can't currently access. And even though Lytle recognizes the need for consolidation, he says this is unfair.
We are concerned, though, that when the dollars that we have for education are very limited, that much of it needs to be taken for the study of the reorganization throughout North Dakota. $7 million spent in reorganization means that all of us are getting about $65 less per student, and that hurts.
Dave Wahlberg for Prairie Town Meeting.
All right, let's spend a few minutes talking about the pros and cons of larger school districts cooperating or merging or whatever you'd like to call it. Our guests for this section of the program here in Fargo, Mark Jens, who is president of the West Fargo School Board, who can address this particular topic quite directly. Mark, thanks for being with us tonight. In Towner, we have, Dr. Ed Mundy, who is the superintendent of schools in Minot. Dr. Mundy, thanks for joining us tonight.
Thank you.
And in Bismarck, we have Dr. Wayne Sandstead, happens to be the superintendent of public instruction for North Dakota. Dr. Sandstead, we're happy to have you with us tonight as well.
Evening, Charlie.
Let's start with Ed Mundy in Towner. Dr. Mundy, I understand you're not a real big fan of the restructuring program. Why not?
From the state. And we believe that it should be spread out all over to every student. The restructuring is going to a very few students, thereby helping a very small number of students. And it could help all the students in the whole state if we were put on the foundation aid.
Okay. Dr. Sandstead, is it a legitimate stand for large schools to not support the restructuring program if there is no particular money in it for them?
Well, of course, we're concerned, Charlie, as I think all school people in the state of North Dakota are, from school boards, administration, teachers, certainly parents, I hope, that the state's commitment to education, its responsibility really as its first element of government's involvement with citizens, has not kept pace. Now, on the other hand, I've been in front of the Senate committee for days on end now watching amendments and motions. I don't hear a thing about anybody looking to providing that money to the regular foundation aid payment. It's a loss. It's a total loss if we don't get it. And from that perspective, I think the requirement that the legislature is considering to cut, in effect, a program that's working and going ahead and could well make a difference in terms of the efficiencies, ultimately, in the financial resources available to all the students in the state, has to be our prime concern.
So the legislature really isn't trying to decide where in education this money is going to go. This is either going to go to the restructuring program or it's going to go to something else then, right?
The 12 largest districts in the state, of course, have about half of our pupils right now. But we have to be concerned about the total state's opportunities for education. That includes all those folks in the other 268 districts across the state. And from that perspective, we have to suggest that this program is a real vehicle, has a real record already in the consortium's operating, and holds great potential for the future of educational opportunity in the state. From that perspective, I think it's important that the state provide these kind of resources to the consortium.
Dr. Mundy, since the money is either going to go to consortium formation or to something else, does that change the way you'd feel about this at all?
Well, that's kind of the way the whole budget in the state is organized. The money goes someplace else rather than for the general education in elementary and secondary. We've seen this year after year since 1981, where the school budgets for elementary and secondary have not increased. The money is going someplace else. The problem that I have with some of the consortiums that are set up now, they're not the small schools. These schools have 100 to 150 students per in their high school. Let's talk about the 56 schools that have less than 40 in their high school. These are the students, I believe, are really hurting as far as education is concerned. They need all the help they can get.
In fact, I understand there's a bill in the House, Dr. Mundy, I think it's one Representative Dalrymple has put forth, that would reduce funding for schools under 50 enrollment within 20 miles of another school, kind of forcing them to take part. I take it you'd support that then?
Would not only force them to look at other schools to cooperate with and, in the long run, reorganize, but it would improve the quality of education of those students.
Okay, before we go to our audiences, I'd like to ask Mark Jans a little bit about the Fargo-West Fargo talks. You met for the second time last night, and every time as a reporter in Fargo, I've seen a lot of stories done about this, and every time we say the word merger, everybody goes, oh, no, that's not a merger. Tell us what it is that you're talking about.
Well, currently, Charlie, we're communicating for the first time in about 11 years. Our goal is to initially start up the process of cooperating and sharing of services. But because the districts are so different, West Fargo is a reorganized district, Fargo has their own place in the Century Code, that to make this marriage, as Dr. Bennett called it, work, we have to understand the vehicles that we have to utilize to achieve it. And they have rules governing the areas of transportation, governing the areas of mill levies that we do not have. So there are some legal aspects that need to be covered prior to even thinking merger.
So you're talking then about cooperating perhaps in some educational programs. Could we see some joint classes, for instance, between Fargo and West Fargo? We wouldn't have to use satellite between Fargo and West Fargo.
That's correct. And last night, the meetings have been such that we find it difficult sometimes to communicate openly in the type of meetings we have. But what we are at, or the area we're at now, is we need to talk about real dollars. We talked about spending something like $20 million in the next couple of years building schools. Well, we need to communicate between the two districts as can we share the buildings themselves in a manner without merger? Are there vehicles we can use that allow us to spend our money wisely so we can spend more for the student?
And perhaps have to maybe, by better use of buildings, you could avoid having to build a school sooner than just for one school district? Is that something that's crossed your mind?
Well, exactly, but how do you work that out amongst the people that are paying for this?
Okay.
We don't have that answer.
We have, I'd like to go to Bismarck. Dave Thompson is standing by with someone whose name has been mentioned already, I guess. Dave?
That's right, Charlie. I think you'll recognize Representative Jack Dalrymple of Castleton. He tells me he's going to defend himself first, then ask a question. So, Jack.
Charlie, I heard you mention my name, so I had to come out of the audience here. House Bill 1347 would force a little activity on the part of some smaller schools, but I wanted to point out that there are two things that the schools could do to avoid any penalties under that legislation. Number one, they could join a consortium, or number two, they could form a cooperative operating agreement with any other school. So my idea is that actually they would in the end probably suffer no penalties at all if they make a few adjustments. But I'd like to ask a question of Superintendent Sandstead. The question is, how can we as legislators justify beginning a consortium program statewide only to shut the door when people are still going through? Can we not appeal to legislators just on the basis of fairness that we should finish this program which we've begun?
Dr. Sandstead?
Well, thank you very much, Representative Dalrymple. I appreciate that question, needless to say, because it's the argument that's been going on almost an hourly basis on the Senate committee side. And will ultimately, I believe, hit the floor tomorrow. I do want to add, too, that we've had a couple bills this session that have surprised us because there is some real strong sentiment out there about forced reorganization and consolidation, something that we're trying our best to avoid. A bill for open enrollment across the state received 25 votes just the other day in losing, but the fact that that could take place right now on the House floor, I think says something about the sentiment of the legislators in dealing with this topic. And I do believe that at this time it's such a mistake to not to continue the kind of momentum and the kind of good leadership to support those risk takers out there in communities who are now building consortium activity at a fantastic momentum. And I'm terribly impressed. I've visited consortiums. As I sit in the audience for a couple hours at a time and listen to local decision makers trying to figure out ways in which they can share even more facilities and resources, teacher time, administrative time. It's encouraging, it's exciting, it's invigorating. So I think it'd be really a mistake at this time to stop that kind of forward movement. And sad to say, it's not just the consortium money that lost, that at one time was down $4 million this week, but the technology, and that's been stressed a couple times in the earlier parts of the program. Our efforts to provide, and I think they go hand in glove, the ability to have a good technology program in place with the consortium movement is showing results already across the state. Seven classes are being offered in one of the consortiums that I visited. Probability and statistics, foreign language, art education, never available and certainly never available to districts by themselves in those consortiums.
Certainly the two programs are not mutually exclusive. You brought up we have a question waiting in Towner, but Dr. Sandstead, you brought up this open enrollment question. They've gone to a form of that in Minnesota. What would happen in North Dakota if all of a sudden parents could register their students anywhere they wanted to? Is this something you think would be a good deal?
Well, I certainly don't favor that kind of approach because I think it would really wreak havoc with communities across the state. And it would not provide for an orderly and a planned process into the kind of change that's necessary. Minnesota right now, and my fellow commissioner in Minnesota, I note, is saying there should be no school districts in Minnesota under 1,300 pupils, 400 in the high schools alone. That kind of forced consolidation is going to do no one any good. It's just going to build enmity and discord between communities, much as I think the open enrollment provision would do in North Dakota.
And I know you've been following that, and you've heard there Mr. Momingay's proposal has raised a lot of discussion. We have a question waiting in town, or I believe Larry Gagelman has another question.
Yes, I'd like to direct this to the legislators, and I don't know who's there as legislator, so I guess I just wonder how in good faith the legislature can at this point change the direction that we're headed. We entered in the North Central Consortium under House Bill 1507, and all of a sudden, as of today, we're taking an about face and going in a different direction, and how in good faith the legislature can do that to us.
We don't have any legislators on the panel right now, Larry, unless Jack Dalrymple is standing by. But let's hear first what Dr. Mundy has to say about this. Obviously, you and Superintendent Gagelman would be at odds over this.
No, not really. They have started the consortium, and I think they should continue for their two other years. I just can't see spending additional state money for additional co-ops, because I believe the schools can co-op in many, many ways without the additional $165 per student.
Okay, I don't know. Okay, we have a reaction, I guess, available in Bismarck. Jack?
Yes, we do, Charlie. Okay. This is Representative Moyne Gates from Grand Forks, who sits on the House Education Committee. As a matter of fact, he's the chairman of the House Education Committee. Moyne? Would you like to respond to the question?
I don't know if I can respond to the question. I was sitting back there quietly because I was going to be on the panel later on. But and the bill right now that deals with the dollars in the consortium is still on the Senate side, and I've been talking to some individual senators to try to encourage them to keep as much money in that as they possibly can, because I think it's important. I agree we made some commitment as a legislative session during the last legislative session. I come from a large school district, but I fought quite a bit during the last session to get 1507, the consortium consolidation program, started. I want to keep it going. I think it's important to provide the best education possible we can for all the students across the state. And while I'm up here, I'd like to ask a question of Dr. Ed Mundy. As I said, a statement first, just what I said, I think educating all students across the state as we best can is important. The larger districts, we're all hurting, but the larger districts, through the size factor, are able to offer programs that in a more efficient manner. You mentioned a lot of school districts under 40. Is it your recommendation that this legislative body or the next one force closing of school districts under 40 or 50 in number? And I tried a little bit of that last session, was unsuccessful. How do you propose we go about that process?
Well, I guess the legislature job is yours. Running a school as superintendent is mine. Maybe I can't tell you how to do your job, but I do appreciate money to help me do mine.
Nice move, Dr. Money, nice move. Okay, and it's nice that that Representative Gates was willing to come out of the audience knowing he's going to be a panelist later. We sort of mix and match things here. I think we have a question standing by in Towner, John.
Okay, let's get off that subject just for a second and change the subject. Can I get your name and where you're from?
John, I'm Father Tim Bushy from Towner in Granville. I have a question in regards to the opportunities that the consortium and consolidated opportunities in educational districts throughout the state might have on lifelong learning and increasing the opportunities, and if any work or planning is being done with our colleges and universities in the state of North Dakota to provide more adult ed opportunities for our adult population in the state of North Dakota.
Okay. Dr. Sandsted, is that something you'd like to respond to?
Well, Charlie, and thanks, Father, for the question again, because I think it does portend a tremendous potential for the future of utilizing community education resources, including higher education throughout the state, for the benefit of each community program that would really help in the development of the community. And from that perspective, we're looking at, we have an OCAR group, organizations concerned about rural education forming. That organization is already planning a pilot project in North Dakota to see how well, because they're impressed with our consortium activity, they want to see how much they can do to bring community together to restructure the school, not only in terms of its educational enterprise, but indeed in its worth to community. From that perspective, we have tremendous potential.
Okay, thank you, Dr. Sansa, and thank you, Father Bushy. Used to be in Fargo. It's nice to see you again, Father Bushy, and I hope you'll forgive us for having this program during Lent on a Wednesday night. It just worked out that way, you know, and we're glad you could be here, by the way. Bob Dambach has a question. Bob?
Well, there are many different ways this question has been asked, and there are people out there that are wondering if there's any scientific information or results of studies done about the quality of education in a large school district as compared to a small school district. Is there any difference? And if there is, how has this been measured?
We're going to put Mark Jens on the spot here. You come from a larger school district. Is there any difference in the quality between your district and a smaller one?
Well, I think not, Charlie. I think if anything is what the people alluded to from the smaller school districts stating that they could not afford to have a curriculum that included sometimes a foreign language, advanced math, or something in that area. I don't think that the teachers that are teaching the English, the entry-level math in Beach, North Dakota, or West Fargo, North Dakota, are any different. But I do think, just from the size and scope of the curriculum at times, that a larger school district is enabled to offer more courses than some of the small schools.
We're talking in many cases, if we get down to brass tacks, we're talking about money, right? Isn't it more likely that the funding is going to be more stable for a larger school district, especially when you look at a case where many of the rural school districts are losing population? Is that kind of what we're up against here, dollars?
My answer to that is yes. But West Fargo is a little unique in that we currently educate our students for about $2,700 per student, which is well below the state average. In essence, about $700 lower. And when we look at that, not all big schools have the ability or the tax base to broaden the scope of their curriculum either. So it isn't small school, big school all the time. It's what the district itself from a local tax base can offer. And unfortunately, we're one of those districts with a low tax base.
Okay, thank you to our panelists. I'm sure we will hear from some of them again. I know we'll hear from some of them again because some of them are still going to be panelists. The merging of several school districts into one raises all kinds of complicated circumstances, not the least of which is what to call these new mega districts. Now, maybe this isn't the most serious problem, but consider this television sportscast of the not too distant future.
Good evening, sports fans. We've got a busy night of high school sports action, so let's begin. In Eastern Conference action, the Grafton, Drayton, Park River, Minto, St. Thomas, Pembina, Cavalier, Walhalla, Edinburgh, Mountain Hoople, Chargers narrowly squeaked past the Cooperstown, Finley, Sharon, Portland, Mayville, Hillsboro, Northwood, Annetta, Binford, Hope, Galesburg, Hunter, Vikings, 60-56. Said Grafton, Drayton, Park River, Minto, St. Thomas, Pembina, Cavalier, Walhalla, Edinburgh, Mountain Hoople coach Fred Johnson, the Cooperstown, Finley, Sharon, Portland, Mayville, Hillsboro, Northwood, Annetta, Binford, Hope, Galesburg, Hunter, Vikings really know their defense. As I said, a busy night in sports, but that's all we have time for tonight. Thanks for joining us.
You know, that really is almost happening now. We have some nights on our sportscast where you can't get the whole name on the screen because there are so many schools, but it works out fine. We managed to get the scores in. Well, even more than with individual school districts, the future of North Dakota's consolidation effort lies with the legislature. So our next panel will help us wrap up this evening's discussion by looking at whether or not the legislature is fully committed to school consolidation. And I guess we've had some previews of this, first of all, but our guests for this segment in Bismarck, Representative Moyne Gates, whom you met a moment ago in the audience. Magically, he's on the panel. Representative Gates, thanks for being with us tonight. And also in Bismarck, Dr. Wayne Sandsted. Dr. Sandsted, thanks for staying in your chair a little bit longer and answering some questions. And we won't put him on the spot necessarily, but we know Jack Dalrymple's in the audience out there too, so if he wants to comment, I'm sure he will. And who knows what other legislators are lurking in the audience in Bismarck, huh? Let's talk to Dr. Sandsted again here for a second. Any comments from you about the discussion we've heard so far tonight? particularly transportation problems and fear of losing local schools. How do you comfort people?
Well, Charlie, I think we're talking once again about the kind of availabilities and opportunities that a student has in their districts. Clearly, if we could even get the kind of foundation payment that I'd like to see, in fact recommended, with a $400 to $700 per pupil increase, that's not going to solve the problem of a greater majority of our school districts in the state at this time as their dwindling student populations drop. From that perspective, I think we are tackling a problem that has meaning across the state, and that certainly the pilots that are underway, the work that's being done in consortiums across the state, indicate that when you can reduce a teacher's load from 5 to 6 preparations a day to 1 or 2 a day, and they can specialize in that subject matter and that content material, you're getting quite a different education. And it's a wonderful opportunity, as was indicated, I think, earlier tonight by one of the panelists. It reinvigorates the entire staff. It gives new potential to the fact that those students have specialists available to them in subject matter areas that will make a lot of difference in the kind of quality program that they have. Many of the large districts, of course, have been providing this just as a matter of their regular operation at the school.
This sort of goes, this whole issue kind of goes beyond just the schools, though, doesn't it? The very title of this program, At the Heart of Our Town, kind of speaks to the emotion that becomes involved in this. How do you help explain this program, or, as I said before, comfort people who are afraid that by consolidating they're going to lose a school which may be the center of their community, when already they've seen a lot of problem in the economy with dwindling population? Now there's what they perceive as a threat to their school. Is there any way that you can arrange this system or make them feel that this system will actually help them maintain their community identity?
Well, I think their sense of community is going to grow larger, and that some of the old town rivalries and old time rivalries will probably disappear in the process. But we're already seeing in consortiums that are operating tremendous parent involvement and parent support of the program. In many cases, they are out in front, indicating the kind of changes they would like to see within their school district. From that perspective, we widen the whole aurora of responsibility, moreover, a representation in those communities, and I think that's to everybody's benefit.
Representative Gates, what's your take now on the legislature, the way the discussion is going? Is the legislature going to follow through on the consortium program, or is it going to die?
Well, Charlie, I think the legislature is going to follow through on it. It's not going to be as big as what was in the governor's budget. I think everybody can see it. The frustration for everyone in the education field and the legislators on the Hill is that there's not enough money. As I said earlier, I'm from a larger school district, and my backing of the consolidation consortium that's going on is hurting my district to a certain extent because it's less dollars going there. I'm willing to do that, and I think a number of other people are, because we're concerned about the education of all the youth across the state. I said the legislature, I believe, is going to come up with a package. It's not going to be as large as what the governor's package would have liked, but I'm going to fight to keep as much in that budget for consortium and consolidation as I can. But it's going to take a lot of other people working towards that also.
Okay, we have some questions in the audience. We're going to get to. I'm going to do a little freelance directing here from the. No one can stop me, right? Because I've got the microphone. I know Jack Dalrymple, the representative from Castleton, is in the audience. As we move on here, at some point when he's close to a microphone, I'd like to ask him how he feels about the way the consolidation has worked in his district, because there have been school consolidations in Cass County. Maybe if I stall long enough, he'll get there to answer the question now. We have Castleton Central, Cass, and a number of different consolidations. And here he is through the magic of television. Representative Dalrymple, how has it worked? Can you lay to rest any fears that people have about consolidations, or have you seen some manifestation of their concerns?
Well, I have seen, Charlie, I think both great benefits and also problems, as the superintendent said earlier, but it's a dynamic program. I remember one evening in Arthur, we had 6 school boards seated in the Arthur Gymnasium in a circle, all facing each other and discussing this question of a consortium. And no one had ever even imagined a year earlier that anything like that could possibly occur. So it's had a tremendous effect out there.
So you've seen that people reluctant at first have found that it works?
I think it's, as Tom Decker said, it's still too early in the program to really know, you know, if we can say that it works per se. It's something that we have to make work, and we're finding that it's hard work to make it work. But this is not the time to pull back and give up on the program. This is the time to push forward.
Okay, thank you. Thank you for helping out with that, Representative Dalrymple. We have a question here in Fargo.
Take advantage of the legislators and Superintendent Sandstedt out in Bismarck. When we talk about the teachers being the 48th in the state as far as pay level, where does North Dakota stand in the United States in terms of the state funding of education? And then to the legislators, when we look at the levels of funding, how do we justify as a state basically 10 years of level funding with no increase whatsoever and expect to continue providing quality education?
Okay, Dr. Sandstedt, perhaps you could tackle the first part of that question.
Well, that's a question that we ask of legislators on almost a daily basis again. The fact of the matter is there has to be some priority given to the preparation of students at the elementary and secondary levels. And from that perspective, we've lost some ground. We've certainly lost ground, as indicated in the amount of state revenue that now goes to public schools. We almost on a daily basis, again, sad to say, I see the general fund being drained for all kinds of worthy and valuable programs, perhaps. But when the general fund doesn't have revenue in it, the fact of the matter is those funds can't be made available to schools. So that's one reason we've gone through four major cutbacks in the last couple years of each biennium.
Do you have on the top of your head the figure we're looking for, how North Dakota ranks nationwide in its funding of education?
Well, we've lost ground again. We were 38th. I believe we've dropped considerably below that in any kind of new statistic.
Okay. Representative Gates, did you want to have any response to the question about financing of education?
Well, Charlie, the statistics that Dr. Sandstedt said are true. The idea that I guess that the legislators up on the Hill have to make, and also the citizens of the state, is they've got to set their priorities. We've got a problem in this state. We're requiring a lot of services, but we're having fewer and fewer citizens to pay for those services. The services requests for services are not going down, and education is one of the bigger ones. We've got to make up our mind in the state. Do we follow what the Constitution says, and that's provide for education and quality education? I want to jump back just a little bit to I don't remember his name, the gentleman from Towner. I believe it was the superintendent of schools at Towner or administrator there. I was glad to hear that. That's one of the first individuals I've heard say that he's looking to the future. We've done a decent job in the past, but we have not been thinking about preparing students for the 21st century, and I think that's what we should be looking at.
Okay, we have a question waiting in Towner, I believe, John.
Thank you, Charlie. Could I get your name?
Clarissa Feeblecorn.
Where are you from?
Towner, substitute teacher. And my question is, why can't we take more advantage of those of us who are over age and grade and who have retired or who are simply available to teach to help in some of these, the ITV, for instance, or in adding extra materials to the youngsters here?
Okay, sure.
Who'd like to tackle that one? Moyne, have any comment?
There's no reason. I think whether you're a retired teacher or whether you're just a citizen of a school district, there's no reason why that as long as you let the individuals know in the school district, they'd be glad, I think, to get any kind of help they can get in educating the youth in that school district.
Okay, we're getting near to running out of time here, but I believe we have a question waiting in Bismarck, Dave.
Thank you, Charlie. And your name, sir?
Herman Sonduck.
Hey,
well, my observation has been, as a businessman, that the amount of money spent on education doesn't necessarily guarantee quality of education. as an employer, I had employees that could not spell, they could not do fractions, they could not figure percentages, and I had to teach them. And that is my observation, that the money spent not necessarily improves the education of the student. And that is all.
Okay. Okay, thank you for that comment. It's a good thing it wasn't a question because we don't have time for an answer. Bob Dambach here is here, however. We do have time for some final figures on tonight's voting. Bob?
Okay, well, they're not quite final because you still can call in and you can let the legislators know what you think about this issue. We'll be here after the show is over and we will register that. Right now it's running neck and neck. It's about 50-50, 51 yes, 54 no. That's changed back to exactly 50-50 in the last 2 moments. You can let the people know what you think by your phone call, toll-free number. We also want to send you our viewers resource guide. We'll get your name and address and send it out. And I want to thank all of you who called in tonight with your questions, and thanks for calling. Back to Charlie.
Okay, Bob, thank you, and thank you for giving us those questions, helping out that way. That's Prairie Town Meeting for this evening. I want to thank our viewers at home and here in our three studios, John Vigestead and Towner.
Thank you very much, Charlie. One vote here. We took a straw poll, 28 votes yes, no votes. That's the way it turned out here.
Okay, so was that a surprise to you?
Not really. I think the people who are in this particular library are quite interested in consortiums.
Okay. And in Bismarck, what's the feeling there, Dave?
I don't know if I have a real strong feeling either way on this. I just wanted to make mention that we'll probably see something tomorrow in the news. You'll hear it or watch it or something like that on what happens to the consortium bill in the Senate.
That's right. It will be probably acted on in some fashion tomorrow. Prairie Town Meeting was created with a grant from the Farmers Home Administration as a national pilot project to explore how television can be used to improve the quality of life in rural America. And as such, we've all been part of a national experiment this year. We've discussed economic development, waste management, social services, and of course tonight education, each as a statewide discussion via satellite and microwave. We've brought our cameras to Fargo, Bismarck, Minot, and Grand Forks, and we've given a statewide voice to communities that don't often get to participate in live television. Hazen, Lakota, Watford City, Towner, and we believe this experiment has been a success. Now we're working on our second year. We'd like to hear your comments and suggestions, but most of all, we want to thank you for taking part in this national experiment by speaking your mind on Prairie Town Meeting. Thank you and good night.
Prairie Town Meeting is made possible through a grant from the Farmers Home Administration.